amigos.
Hola.
Hola, amigas.
Hola.
Do I need to do something? Yeah, push the green button.
Dice que está muy contento de estar aquí. Muy contento. La primera vez en España. Por eso yo ando con un Casio, ¿eh? Y papel.
Anyway, it's great to be back. And I really have enjoyed seeing all of you, a few for the second time and most of you for the first time. I'm really happy to be here. I'm really happy that all of you are here. And what I'm going to do for you tonight is give you a progress report on a project I've been working on, which I started before most of you were born. You might be thinking, wow, that's a long time for a software project. That's pretty overdue, don't you think? And the answer is yes. We're up. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about the Procession Protocol, which is the latest name for this project. Let's see, could we have it on that display, please? So, here we go. Okay, in the beginning. So, even before I was born, the way we used to use computers was you turn the computer on and there was no program in it. So you had to first load a tiny little program called a bootstrap. And it was usually tricky to get that into the machine. And then it would start running. And its job was to load the next program. And it was a little bit more complicated. And then it could load your program and then it would run. And then the next time someone wanted to run a program, they'd start over. And that was a really awkward, confusing system. So an important innovation was the operating system. Thank you. So the original operating system was a resident program loader, so that you didn't have to go through the bootstrap process every time you wanted to run a program. The bootstrap would stay in memory and it would load all the programs. The next step was an input-output manager so that all the devices could be accessed the same. We did that with standard device drivers and file systems and allowed any program to interact with any device, even on different machines. That was a really useful thing. But the most important thing we got from operating systems Thank you. Maybe I should just wave at you from now on. Would that be better? The processes. Processes are tied for the most important discovery in the history of computer science. It's where we have a piece of memory, and we can put a program in that memory, and the program cannot interact with stuff outside of that memory. So that protects the operating system, because if the program could crash the operating system, then what's the point of having an operating system? We still have to keep starting over, and we don't want to do that. So that was the first use of the word security in this field. I'm going to get rid of this. I'll just use my hands. I'll be like a wizard, right? But not yet. Anyway, the original meaning of the word security in a computer context was that an ordinary program could not crash the operating system. Later, we discovered malware and all that other nasty stuff, adware and spyware. And so we have a new definition of security now. It's more than just defending the operating system against incompetence. It's defending it against evil. But now, well, never mind. Okay, so let's move on. Oh, great. Thank you so much. Okay, so a process is a secure memory container for a program. Processes tend to be very heavy when they're managed by operating systems, because when you change from one process to another, you have to store a lot of registers, and the number of registers keeps growing with each generation of hardware. And you also have to update the page tables if you're using virtual memory, and that's a really tedious process. Processes allow for multitasking, which allows many programs to run almost simultaneously by taking turns. You know, so you can run one program for a while, suspend it, run another program for a while, and so on. That's called time slicing. On more modern systems, we have multiprocessing, which means we can literally run multiple programs at the same time, and because of the wonderful features of processes, they don't interfere with each other. There we go. Okay, so, but just having independent processes is great, but it's not enough. We want to have inter-process communication, because there are lots of interesting things that can happen if the processes can work together. And there are lots of techniques for allowing for that communication. The three most popular are memory sharing, file I/O, and message passing. So, memory sharing is the most popular, and it's also the most dangerous, and so I don't recommend it. Memory sharing works well if the shared memory is immutable, meaning that no process can share the thing or can alter the thing that's being shared. But if the shared memory is mutable, then bad things can happen. You get races and deadlocks and the sorts of problems where you have to turn the machine off and on to fix it. That's very often caused by this. So the better approach is message passing, where a process is able to send a message to another process. And that's the form that I'm advocating. We call these machines computers, but they do a lot more communicating than computing. And so maybe we should consider giving them a better name, but we should at least change our focus about what's actually going on here. Processes are too important to be left to the operating system, which is why I think processes should be moved into the programming language. Erlang demonstrated how to do this, and I think that should be the future of all languages. So when you program with processes, you have a new programming model where processes are sending messages to other processes. That's the new model of communication. I call that processional programming. Much like programming with functions was functional programming, and programming with objects was object-oriented programming. So let me demonstrate what could happen here. So here we have a worker. It's a program running in a process. And in the old way of thinking, it could be a big, big program, and it does all kinds of things. But that's not the model I'm advocating. I want to break this into lots of smaller processes. So the worker is very powerful because it can do everything. I don't want anybody to be able to address all that power. So to make it safer, the worker creates another process which runs a program called agent. And the agent will represent it. And because the worker created the agent, they have a special relationship which is indicated by the arrow, which says that each knows the address of the other. And because it knows the address, it can send a message to the other process. So meanwhile, we have a client. And the client wants to be able to talk to the worker, but it doesn't know the worker's address. So instead, it is going to send a message. Oh, before we do that, the client could be in the same machine, or the client could be in a different machine. I'm using the dotted line to indicate a machine boundary. Inside that dotted line is the internet, right? So they could be any distance apart. I'm showing them here being slightly adjacent. So the agent, or the client, can send a message to the agent. And they can do that because it knows the agent's private address. And in that message, it's going to ask for an introduction to the worker. Now, the agent doesn't want to do that. It doesn't want anybody to talk to the worker directly. So instead, it creates a new process running the liaison program. And the liaison is given the address of the worker. The client is not given the address of the worker. And then the agent sends a reply message to the client, and that message contains the address of the liaison. So the client thinks it's getting the worker's address, but he's really getting the liaison. And that's going to turn out to be important. Now, so the client is now set up, it can send messages to the liaison, but that's not its job. So it's going to create a minion. The minion is going to do the work. So, and the client gives the address to the minion. So the minion can now send messages to the liaison. And there's the message. It's going to ask the worker to do some work. The liaison gets the message and will make a decision. Do I want to forward that to the worker or not? It can. It could not. It could suppress the message and say, no, that message is out of bounds. Or it could edit the message in order to make it safe or to annotate where it came from. But then the message gets to the worker, and then some work will happen. So we could have lots of minions, and we could have them all talking to the same liaison. But if we give each one its own liaison, which we should do because they're really cheap, it's just a little bit of memory, we get the advantage that if we decide that one of these minions shouldn't be allowed to make any more requests, we can tell that liaison stop forwarding all messages. And that essentially revokes the permission that we gave to the liaison. And these liaisons could be sitting in separate machines, so we can be distributing stuff out all over the internet. Now, when I started, I showed this picture, how the worker created the agent, the client is connected to the agent, but how did the client know the address of the agent? So I'm going to explain that. So I'm going to go back in time. So here's the client. The agent knows that there are processes that are going to want to connect, but they haven't yet. So it creates a greeter. A greeter is a special kind of process which has a public address. And if you know the public address of the greeter, you can talk to it. So the worker, or the client, knows the greeter's network address and the greeter's public key. Having that information is sufficient to allow it to make a connection to the greeter. And then the greeter can look at the credentials that get provided in that message and decide what to do next. And in this case, it's going to send a message back to the client, giving it the address of the agent. Okay? So I call this the procession protocol, and that's the logo, which might look vaguely familiar, but it doesn't have to look familiar. The procession protocol is based on the SAFE protocol, which is something they developed a few years ago, which provides for the ability to set up secure connections between machines. One of the nice properties of the SAFE protocol is that you can set up a secure connection with authentication in one round trip, which is pretty efficient. But even better than that, you can include the first request and response in that same round trip. So effectively, it can set up and authenticate a secure connection in zero round trips. I don't think you can go faster than that. So it's going to be a very high performance transport. Then within that protocol, I'm going to use something called KIM, which is a byte-oriented encoding using a 7th-bit continuation. It's similar to UTF-8, except it's a little bit smaller and a little bit faster. I've also developed something called NOTA. NOTA is a JSON-like binary encoding with blobs and private process addresses. And you may be wondering, why did the guy who came up with JSON come up with something to replace JSON? This is not intended to replace JSON generally, but there are some things that I need the processional protocol to do that JSON doesn't like to do very well. And that includes private addresses of processes and blobs. Blobs are binary large objects, which are great for representing public keys and IP addresses and lots of other good stuff. And I need those, and JSON doesn't do them very well. So I have this new notation called NOTA. So the nice thing about the precession protocol is it does not care what languages the programs are written in. So you could have one program written on Rust, and another machine you could have one written in Erlang, and they can talk to each other through this protocol. A good protocol does that. But we've been through many programming paradigms now, and all of these paradigms, each one is better than the one that came before it, but something they all have in common is the assumption that a program runs in a single machine. And that's just not true in the modern world. Programs are distributed over lots of machines. We've been doing that now for many years. So I think we should have a programming language which understands the new paradigm, which is secure distributed programming. And the precession protocol is optimized for that model. So to do that, I'm developing a new programming language called MISTI. And I call it MISTI because it's vaporware. I've been designing this program for over 40 years, and it's not quite done yet. And I'm not going to make a promise that it'll ever be done. But this is a progress report, and I've been making progress, and I'll tell you about what I've got in MISTI so far. So strictly speaking, you do not need a new programming language to do the distributed process paradigm, but a new language definitely helps us to think in terms of messages. And since messages are fundamental to this, I think that's a good place to start. MISTI is a transitional language. It combines message passing with a traditional functional language. It's possible to have a language which is only message passing and no functions. And I know people who are working on that, and I think that's brilliant and ultimately the future, but I think that's too large a step. And generally, industry is very suspicious of large steps, and so I think a transitional language is more likely to find adoption. Industry likes little steps. So there have been other transitional languages. Maybe the most famous is C++, and I hope that MISTI is nowhere near as crappy as C++. That's a goal. It's not a certainty, but it's a goal. So I want to take the best of current practice and add an expansion kit of secure communicating process functionality. So the influences on MISTI include JavaScript, Brendan Knight's brilliant language. I started by taking JavaScript and correcting every design mistake, every one, all fixed. You end up with a language that looks very different, but shares the same good parts. I was also influenced by Carl Hewitt's actor model, which he developed at MIT in the early 80s, brilliant predecessor of the communicating function model. Mark Miller's e-language, which he developed at my company, Electric Communities, that taught me how to do secure communication within a programming language. Joe Armstrong's brilliant Erlang language, which was developed for real-time systems like telephone switches, which had the most wonderful idea in Erlang was of failure, embracing failure in order to get reliability, which sounds ridiculous, but it's the way forward. It's the right way to do it. And finally, Carl Sassenroth's rebel language, much neglected language, but it was brilliant. It was one of the inspirations for Jason, and I continue to find inspiration in it. So the thing I like most about MISTI is that the concurrency model, the communication model, and the security model all come from a single mechanism. If you can figure out how to do message passing, you get all three of these. And it's not like you have to do some security and then you do some communication. They all happen together. It's one mechanism that solves all three problems. So a process runs in a machine. A process communicates with other processes only by message passing. There is no shared memory even between processes in the same machine, so it's a pure process model. A process can create new processes in its own machine. Every process has an unguessable private address. If you have a process's private address, you can send messages to that process. Messages can contain private addresses. You saw a demonstration of that. Processes can have state, which can change based on received messages. So it's a stateful language. Incoming messages are queued, if necessary, delivered in arrival order. A process will not be given the next message until it is done with the previous message. And ongoing messages sent by a process will be held until it's done. This is a reliability mechanism. If a process sends some messages and then gets sick and falls down, we don't want those messages to go out because it could cause contamination. And a process's turn may be time-sliced. So this solves a problem we have in JavaScript. If you have something that wants to run a long time, you can't do that in JavaScript because it holds the thread. But we can do time slicing in MISTI, so other things can continue to run. So you can have one long process, you don't have to isolate it, it's already isolated. So the key to programming in this environment is acquiring private addresses. And there are exactly three ways you can acquire an address. One is by creation. When a process creates a new process, it receives the new process's private address. By construction, a process can be dowered with private addresses when it is made. And by introduction, a process can receive messages containing private process addresses. So it's important to have robustness. I mean, it's hard to get a single program and a single machine robust. It gets much harder when you have a distributed system and there are many more points of failure. So we need to be able to have an approach that gives us reliability in such an unreliable environment. So I'll offer two observations on this problem. The first is it's easiest to reason about a program when it is starting up. After it's been running for a while, it's much harder to predict what it's going to do. It is hardest to reason about a program when it is failing unexpectedly. And yet somehow we expect an event handler will fix everything and allow it to keep going. That doesn't work. So failure is always an option. If we recognize that a process is not working correctly, we can stop it and start it over. And we want to fail to a known condition, to a state where we have the best chance of having a full, complete recovery. So here's a big graph. This is what's actually going on in the worker. The worker itself doesn't actually do any work. It has all of these helpers that are doing things. It's got a big tree of processes, and all the work gets distributed over them. And they're all communicating with each other and getting things done. Now suppose this guy over here has a problem. It gets fed some bad data, or has a bug, or something goes wrong, and it's sick. So what do we do? We just stop it. Go stop. and we inform this guy, and its approach might be to start it up again. So it's sort of like turning the power off and on that one process, and everything keeps going. So that's pretty cool. So what if this guy falls down? You know, he gets confused. So he stops, and his subordinates stop, and their subordinates stop. And they all get garbage collected, and it's done. And this guy is informed, your helper is gone. And so it's his job to fix it. And he might go, I don't know how to do that, so bye. So he goes away, and so does that one. And now the worker is informed that those guys are gone. So I know what to do, I'm the worker. I'm going to bring that guy back. He's going to start those guys, and they're going to start that one, and so on. And the system is going again. So we don't have to power off the box. The system is able to repair itself. And we can put network boundaries anywhere in here. These things I showed are all running on one machine, but they could be running all over the data center, or all over the cloud, or all over the world. Recovery works exactly the same way. So let's talk a little bit about performance. So usually, when we talk about performance of a software system, we're thinking about how hard the program is working. But we don't worry enough about how long the program is waiting. And in highly distributed systems, wait time and network latency is the big thing. You can make all the little pieces run faster. It's irrelevant because you're looking at network effects. So this is a protocol timing diagram. The blue ovals are computing. So that's a process running in a machine. And the red lines are waiting for the network. You know, so A is going to do some work and then send a message to B. And then B will do some work and send a message to A. And we can measure how much time that whole thing takes. Okay, everybody with me so far? So there are a couple patterns that we can examine. First one is we can do a sequential thing, where A wants to get something from B and send it to C and send that to D. And so you just have a sequence that works like this. Usually we, so you can do this using remote subroutines or remote procedure calls or remote method indication. Web protocols work like this. Any kind of call response could do this. But there are opportunities to do this better. For example, if we can send the address of C to B and so on, so that each of these guys can just send messages directly to each other. Remote procedure calls cannot do anything like this. So it reduces the amount of time we spent on this computation from that to that. That's a significant speed up. And it didn't require any reprogramming or optimization. It's just we're choosing a more appropriate flow, something which is only possible if you're doing message passing. We could also have a pipeline where we have stuff moving constantly, so it's not just one thing happening. We're just sending data through. You know, this is flow-based programming. And so we can keep the pipeline full all the time and get maximum performance out of the network and all of the nodes in the system. You can't do that with remote procedure calls. Another opportunity is if it turns out that the work that B, C, and D do are independent of each other, we can have them do that work all at once. And that's ultimately the way we get the best performance out of a distributed network, is we try to keep every machine busy. And this does that by having all three of those run at the same time. So again, now the savings is that. That's a pretty big speed up. Again, with virtually no change to our fundamental software. So I want to give you a few proverbs. First is, securing online systems with offline certificates is fundamentally wrong-headed. somehow from the birth of the web, that's how we decide to do things. And I think it makes no sense. We're online. We should take advantage of the fact that we're online. If we're offline, then why do we need certificates? We want programs with strong cohesion and loose coupling, because that gives us the most reliable software. If you have lots of small processes, you get that for free. We want to embrace messaging, not try to hide from it. Lately, we've been seeing things in our languages like async await, which is trying to disguise the fact that there's temporal stuff going on. I don't want to be disguising it, I want to be embracing it. This is how we get better performance, is by understanding how our programs flow through time. And then the law of turns, which is left over from the browser, never wait, never block. In the browser, you also have to add finish fast. But again, because we have time slicing at the process level, we don't need that, so we're more flexible. So this is the MISTI roadmap. This is where I am so far. So I have a language design, and I think it's pretty good. Again, I've been working on it for over 40 years, and I think I finally am getting it right. I've implemented the tokenizer, the parser. DEC64 is a floating point standard that I developed specifically for this language. It uses decimal instead of binary as its basis, which means that the numbers that humans use are computed exactly. You know, I don't know if you've noticed this, but in JavaScript, if you add 0.1 to 0.2, you don't get 0.3. You get something that's really close, but it's not right. And that turns out to be important on a planet where people use the decimal system. Because if you're adding up people's money, you have a legal obligation to get the right sum. And we don't get that with the current number formats, but that fixes it. Parsec is a library which I wrote first for JavaScript, and it will also be available in the MISTI environment, which makes it possible to manage the parallel and the sequential flows very easily. And then I've begun work on the SAFE protocol. So things I have left to do, I'm currently working on the code generator. So my plan is to generate X64 machine language from a MISTI source. And so there won't be a MISTI interpreter, it's just going to run. And it should run pretty fast. Then I have to write the runtime and the intrinsic functions. Then the process control, and my intention is to steal that from Erlang, because Erlang did that brilliantly. Then to finish the processual protocol, which is taking SAFE and putting the new stuff on it. And finally, patterns. I have a pattern matching library, which replaces the regular expressions that are in JavaScript. I think regular expressions are pretty awful. They are so cryptic and weird and so difficult to get right. This is going to be so much better. So if you're interested in this stuff, you can find it at mistysystem.com. The obvious question is this an open source project? And the regrettable answer is not yet. And the reason is that I don't want to open it until I'm confident I've got this stuff right. If I open it now and it turns out I blundered here, then we're stuck with those mistakes forever. And I don't want to be making another JavaScript. I want to get this right. So I may be another year or two before I'm confident that this is solid. And at that point, I'll open it up and I'll be asking for help. And you know, there'll still be lots to do. And eventually, my goal is that this becomes a new standard, that there may be sorts of network services that would really benefit from this ability to make secure connections and to program them effectively. And that could start network effects, which could eventually lead to global domination. But not that I would benefit from that, because, again, it's all going to be free and open. Oh, and that's the end. Okay. Thank you very much.